Good morning, and welcome to this time of worship. Let's begin with a word of prayer. God, in this time of unrest, in this time of change, and in this time of pain in the world, help us to see how your Spirit is at work, always, all around us, always working for good. And help us to be instruments of your peace, and love, and justice in this world. Amen.
From Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 8. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand. And we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The end of the reading.
Saved already. precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus the risen Christ. Amen. It's a dirty job, but someone's got to do it. You've probably heard that phrase any number of times in your lifetime and probably even said it yourself. It's a dirty job, but someone's got to do it. What does that mean? Well, it means that there's a job that needs to be done, but because it involves a great deal of commitment, or involves sacrifice, or taking a risk or two, or having gumption along the way, or whatever you want to add to it, not many people are willing to take it on. It's a dirty job, but someone's got to do it. One of the first generation of reality TV shows was a show entitled Dirty Jobs. And the host, Mike Rowe, would take each episode each week and he'd go off and work with someone whose profession, whose job was not exactly on the top list of jobs that people want. For example, episodes included, and not to be gross about it, but episodes included castrating pigs. Another one included working with someone who was in charge of the waste management water treatment facility and working with all the sludge and raw sewage and cleaning the pipes out and all that. Another episode, he worked the job of a man whose job was to clean out cages at the zoo, animal cages at the zoo. He even took on the role of a young lady who worked as a deodorant tester. And so in that episode, he smelled the armpits of people before and after exercise and exertion of some form or another to make sure that the deodorant in question actually did what it said it could do. You get the point. It's a dirty job, but someone's got to do it. And who knows, folks watching that TV show maybe led to career changes in one direction or another, who knows. But there's one thing that all dirty jobs have in common, and it's this: your hands will show it. Your hands will show it, whether physically with dirt under your fingernails and muck under your fingernails and hard calluses, or even spiritually. You know, you'll be involved in something, your hands will get dirty in a spiritual sense. And that includes and involves stepping out and taking risks along the way. This morning, as we look at Paul's letter to the Romans, the 5th chapter, the first 11 verses, I read that and I think of Jesus' hands. And when I look at Jesus' hands, I see dirty job hands. Why? Because Jesus did the dirtiest job in all human history. The Apostle Paul tells us today about this dirt. He gives us the dirt on the dirt. Sorry, couldn't resist. He says, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And again, he says, while we were enemies of God, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son. It's a dirty job, but someone's got to do it. You know, around Christmas time, we celebrate what theologically we call the incarnation. That is the coming of God in flesh and blood in Jesus and that baby in a manger. And it's a fancy theological way of saying that God got down and dirty with us, sending Jesus to stand down the stench of sin, to embrace our brokenness and to heal our fractured hearts. The hands that were nailed to the cross were cleaning up the mess that we had made. There's an old proverb that my mom used to throw at me quite regularly. You know, Timmy, cleanliness is next to godliness. You probably heard that one before too, maybe even used it before. Well, here's the interesting thing. The gospel really proclaims exactly the opposite. The one who was most godly, the one who was God in flesh and blood and is God in flesh and blood, Jesus, willingly walked into the toxic waste dump that was separating you and me and all of humanity from God's love. Jesus went to the cross, and here's the thing. Here's where it really gets down and dirty. Jesus went to the cross for a world that hated him, a world that reviled him and persecuted him and tortured him and nailed him to a couple of pieces of wood. Jesus' heart was so full of love, and not just any love, but God's love, that he dug his hands deep down into the darkest, dirtiest recesses of my heart and your heart without batting an eye, without flinching. And those dirty hands were what brought forth a miracle, a blessing. Paul uses the word reconciliation a couple of times in this passage. Reconcile, reconciliation between us and God. I was looking at my hands the other day, and I don't know that I've ever really, really looked at my hands as a result of working on this sermon and for today, this message for today. And I thought in looking at my hands and seeing some scars here and there from various things, but wondering when was the last time I got my hands down and dirty in Jesus' name? Maybe you can look at your hands today and ask the same question. Max Lucado, a wonderful writer, tells the story of a man who had spent most of his life as a closet slob. I mean, he just couldn't comprehend the logic of neatness. And I get that. I understand that. I mean, it just, what sense does it make to put the lid back on the toothpaste when you're going to use the toothpaste later on? Anyway, what sense does it make to make your bed in the morning when you're going to sleep in it again at night? That kind of thing, right? The man admitted to being a bit compulsive about his messiness. Then he got married. His wife was patient. She said she didn't mind his habits if he didn't mind sleeping on the couch. Well, he did mind sleeping on the couch. And so he began to change. He said he went through kind of a psychological 12-step program where he retrained his muscles to hang his shirts up, to fold the laundry, to put the cap back on the tube, to put the roll of toilet paper on the toilet paper holder. His nose was reinduced to the smell of Pine Sol. Go figure. By the time his in-laws came to visit, he was a new man. But then came the moment of truth. His wife went away for a week. And for a while, he reverted back to his old self, to the old man. You know, he figured he could just live and be sloppy for 6 days and then clean up on the seventh before his wife got home. But you know, as the first day or so went by, it began to bother him when he'd walk past the sink and see that stack of dirty dishes. He just had to clean them, and so he did. He washed the dishes. He saw that big mound of dirty clothes laying on the bed, and he, oh, I've got to get those taken care of, and it's driving me nuts. So he threw them down the chute, and he did the laundry, and even folded again the laundry. What happened? What happened? Well, it's simple. He had experienced a higher standard of living. And he couldn't go back the old way. He became a neat freak of all things. What kind of hands do your life reflect? What kind of life do your hands reflect? What kind of life do my hands reflect? Are we willing to let the needs of others stain our hands and, you know, break our nails, scar our palms? That's a really important question for us as we live in this age of pandemic, in this age of racial reform, which is so desperately, desperately needed. A systemic change needs to take place. We know that. We've always known that in our heart of hearts as followers of Jesus. That's what he wants from us. Being part of the solution will mean getting our hands dirty. Being Jesus to all people, not just the people who look like us or, you know, live like us. Our hands are going to have to get dirty, friends. Down and dirty. You know, one of the things that really griped the Pharisees and Sadducees about Jesus was that he tended to be always the friend of sinners. That drove the Pharisees and Sadducees nuts. Why would he hang out with riffraff like that? But Jesus did not just hang out with them. He was a hands-on friend to sinners. Let me give you a couple examples from Scripture. John chapter 4, Jesus meets the Samaritan woman at the well, and it's midday and it's hot, and this Samaritan woman, remember Samaritans and Jews did not get along. They disliked each other immensely. Yes, even hatred could be used. And here's this woman who's not only a Samaritan, but she's ostracized by her community because she's been married and divorced 5 times. And so she comes to the well in the middle of the day, in the heat of the day, at noon, when nobody else is around to get their water for the day, because she doesn't want to put up with all the whispering and all the gossip and all the judgment that comes her way when the villagers get together. And so she has this conversation with Jesus, and Jesus takes this water from her and talks to her about he being the living water. She will never thirst again. And her heart is changed. It's renewed. It's filled with the love of Christ. And you know what she does? She becomes the first evangelist in the church. She runs back to the village as fast as she can to tell him about this man who told her everything about her life. He must be the Messiah, the one we've been waiting for. And the whole village came running out to see this Jesus who had gotten his hands dirty. But that's not the only time that happened. Jesus healed the man born blind. You remember that? He took dirt, put it in his hands, spit in his hands, and rubbed that dirt together into a mud paste and put it on the man's eyes and told him to go wash in the pool of Siloam, and he would be healed. And sure enough, it happened that way. He got down and dirty, didn't he? And of course, one of the most famous moments in Scripture, when on Maundy Thursday, Jesus has the Last Supper with the disciples, and then he washes their feet. Now, in those days, feet of those days were not like feet of today. Feet of today are bad enough. But in those days, feet were the dirtiest part of your body. I mean, you had sandals and you walked wherever you went. There was dirt, mud, camel poo and donkey poo. Sorry, but that's the way it was. And here Jesus washes all the disciples' feet, every one of them, including Judas. He washes their feet. He went among the tombs. He went among the pigs and the swine. There was no such thing as anything unclean for Jesus. It's a dirty job, but someone's got to do it. How many of us are afraid to really engage with other people? And, you know, I have fallen to that more times than I care to admit. I was concerned about keeping my hands clean. Yeah. You know, every now and then something makes the rounds of the internet that really is helpful. Go figure. That captures the soul a bit. And so I'd like to share one such story. It goes like this. Grandma, some 90 plus years, sat feebly on the patio bench. She didn't move. She just sat with her head down, staring at her hands. When I sat down beside her, she didn't acknowledge my presence. And the longer I sat, I wondered if she was okay. Finally, not really wanting to disturb her, but wanting to check on her at the same time, I asked her if she was okay. And she raised her head and looked at me and smiled and said, "Oh, yes, dear, I'm fine. Thank you, though, for asking." "Well, I didn't mean to disturb you, Grandma, but you were just sitting there staring at your hands, and I thought I needed to make sure you were okay." Grandma asked her, "Dear, have you ever looked at your hands? I mean, really looked at your hands?" I slowly opened my hands and looked at my palms and then turned my hands over and looked at the back of my hands and thought for a moment, I guess I've never really looked at my hands closely, as I was trying to figure out the point Grandma was trying to make. Well, Grandma smiled and related this story. She said, "Stop and think for a moment about the hands you have, how they've served you well throughout the years. These hands," she said, "though wrinkled, shriveled, and weak, have been the tools I've used all my life long to reach out and grab and embrace life. They braced and caught me when, as a toddler, I fell over and over again upon the floor. They put food in my mouth and clothes on my back. As a child, my mother taught me to fold my hands in prayer. They tied my shoes and pulled on my boots. They dried the tears of my children, your mom, and caressed the love of my life, your grandpa. They wiped my tears when grandpa went off to war. They've been dirty, scraped, and raw, swollen and bent. They were uneasy and clumsy when I tried to hold our newborn daughter. Decorated with my wedding band, they showed the world that I was married and loved someone special. They wrote the letters home and trembled and shook when I buried my parents and your grandpa. They've held children, they've consoled neighbors, shook in fists of anger when I didn't understand. They've covered my face, combed my hair, washed and cleansed the rest of my body. They've been sticky and wet, bent and broken, dried and raw. And to this day, when not much of anything else on me works, these hands hold me up, lay me down, and still continue to fold in prayer. These hands are the mark of where I've been and the times of my life. But you know what, sweetheart? More importantly, it will be these hands that God will reach out, these hands that God will reach out and touch when he leads me home. And with my hands, he will lift me to his side, and there I will use these hands to touch the face of Christ." Well, granddaughter said, "I will never look at my hands the same again, but I remember God reached out and took my grandma's hands and led her home. When my hands are hurt or sore, when I stroke the face of my children and husband, I think of Grandma. I know she has been stroked and caressed and held by the hands of God. I too want to touch the face of God and feel God's hands upon my face. Brothers and sisters in Christ, the incarnation was the greatest dirty job of all time. It was a great come-down story, and Paul articulates that for us today in our lesson from Romans chapter 5. Jesus got down and dirty for you and for me, all the way down, down to the pit of hell and death, where Jesus released the power of sin and death. It was a dirty job. Someone had to do it. And only God could do it. Friends, in a world where people clench their fists more often than not, let us open our hands, you and me, open our hands this week and every moment of our lives. Let's just get them dirty. After all, it's a dirty job, but someone's got to do it. Amen.
And now let us enter into this time of confession and forgiveness. Let us pray. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Hear the good news. There is now no condemnation, for we belong to Christ Jesus. The power of the life-giving Spirit of God has set us free. So be at peace. You are forgiven. We remember that it was in the night in which he was betrayed that our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and poured it out for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And he taught us how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The body of Christ, given for you. And the blood of Christ, shed for you. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Thank you for joining us for this time of worship. Remember that there is a Zoom coffee fellowship hour at 10:30 right after this service. So click on that link and join us for a chance to chat and pray together. We also ask you to keep the Beck family in your prayers. Dave Beck passed away a little over a week ago, and so we ask that you would keep Nancy and the rest of the Beck family in your thoughts and prayers. Now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Hey, church. Hope you're having a great Sunday. I want to give you a little update on some things going on with Bread. Now, for those who don't know, Bread is a coalition of over 40 faith communities in the Columbus area, and Christ Lutheran is one of those faith communities. It's an organization that it spans different faith traditions, and we work together for the sake of justice. So on Wednesday, members of Bread met with Columbus Police Chief Thomas Quinlan about some steps that the police force could take to increase trust in the community, trust with the community. And some context, Bread has been trying to schedule a meeting with Chief Quinlan since February, but he has not been responsive to those requests. However, in light of the current situation in our city and in the country, he reached out to Bread looking for this meeting. So we met. And typically, a first meeting would not have some of requests put on it from Bread to a leader, but because of the situation, the requests that you may be familiar with from a Nehemiah Action meeting were given today at this meeting. So there were three commitments that Bread worked to get from Chief Quinlan. And those revolved around gun violence, restorative justice in our schools, and a municipal ID. Columbus City Council has already done a feasibility study on municipal IDs in the city. And when asked about moving forward with this type of program, many members of council have either said they have not read the study or that the major obstacle is Columbus Police. They don't want a municipal ID program. And Bread asked Chief Quinlan to write a letter saying that he supported such a program to City Council. He was not comfortable writing that letter, as he said he had not read the feasibility study and was not sure of public safety concerns revolving municipal ID program. But he did commit to reading that study. Columbus City Schools and Bread have been working together for quite some time to create a culture of restorative justice practices in the Columbus City School systems. The Superintendent of Schools is a proponent of restorative justice programming in the Columbus City School system and believes in its value. Many teachers and staff have already been trained in such programs, and the results have been very positive. To build on this culture of restorative practice in Columbus City Schools, Bread requested from Chief Quinlan that all of the school resource officers that are stationed in Columbus City Schools receive the same training that the many teachers and staff have already received in the Columbus City Schools to further build this programming. At first, he said, well, only if the school asks for this would we do this kind of training. But it was pointed out to him that training in restorative justice is actually part of the contract between Columbus City Schools and the Columbus Police Department. And once this was pointed out, he was on board with pursuing these trainings. The last request that Bread made to Chief Quinlan was for a commitment to contract with a national network for safe communities to help decrease the gun violence in our city. When given this request, the chief said he was not familiar with the National Network for Safe Communities. And before he could recommend doing such a program, he would need to thoroughly vet the program. He also reminded Bread that he does not create the budget for Columbus Police, but that budget is given to him. He only makes recommendations beforehand. And before recommending to invest in such a program, he would need to vet it. However, Columbus Police has already applied for a grant for this program. So it seems hopeful that this vetting process will not be difficult, and perhaps we will see that in the upcoming budget. The events of these past weeks have shown that there is a lack of trust between the community and the police, not just in Columbus, but in our country. Even though we did not receive commitments from Chief Quinlan in all of our requests today, he did state that he was committed to building trust between the community and the police. Well, there is your update. I hope it was informative. If you have any more questions, please reach out to a network member, a Bread network member from our congregation. There will also be a press conference next week with Bread discussing this meeting with Chief that we had with Chief Quinlan. So look for that next Wednesday. And what does Bread do? Bread rises!